gave us the opportunity to really get to know the Jewish people. Nearly 4 million Jews live here in Poland. But they won't be found among the rural population. Nor have they suffered from the chaos of war as has the native Pole. They set it out indifferently in the gloomy streets of the Polish ghetto. Unlike in 1914, we no longer see just the most grotesque and comical of these questionable ghetto figures. This time we recognize that there's a plague here. A plague that threatens the health of the Aryan peoples. Richard Wagner once said, "The Jew is the demon behind the corruption of mankind." And these pictures prove it. In plain language, Jewish dwellings are filthy and neglected. Untroubled by their surroundings, they go right on with their prayers. The bobbing motion is part of the ritual for reading Jewish scriptures. Seldom are Jews found doing useful work. And when they are, as here, it often isn't voluntary. The German military government is making them clear away rubble. It appears that they're not used to working and don't like it either. These Jews don't want to work, but barter. Here, they're in their element. One might want to regard these haggling children as a sign of great poverty. But watch them a while, and it becomes clear that they're proud to act as their grown-ups do. These young people don't have the idealism that ours do. With them, the egoism of the individual is not in the service of higher common goals. Instead, Jewish morality, in crass contradiction of the Aryan concept of ethics, proclaims the unrestrained egoism of every Jew to be divine law. This is totally incomprehensible to non-Jews. Aryan man attaches a sense of worth to every activity. He wants to create something worthwhile, food or clothing, houses or machines, works of art or anything else of value to everyone. He's ruled by the feeling of being responsible for his achievements. The Jews alter their outward appearance when they leave their Polish haunts for the rich world. The central trait of the Jew is that he always tries to hide his origin when among non-Jews. A bunch of Polish Jews still wearing kaftans. And now in Western European clothes, prepare to infiltrate Western civilization. Of course, these ghetto Jews don't yet move too well in their clean European clothes. Somewhat more adept are the Jews of Berlin. Their fathers and grandfathers lived in the ghetto. But that's not outwardly noticeable. Here, in the second and third generation, the assimilation has reached its zenith. Outwardly, they try to act just like the host peoples. People without good instincts let themselves be deceived by this mimicry and consider Jews the same as they are, for the purity and neatness of the German concept of art. The Jew, without roots of his own, has no feeling. What he calls art must gratify his deteriorating nerves. The stench of disease must pervade it. It must be unnatural, grotesque, perverse, or pathological. These feverish fantasies of hopelessly sick minds were once extolled by Jewish art critics of German public life as high artistic expressions. The Jews' El Dorado was the German stage. Here they ruled unchecked, degrading the classical tradition by appealing to the basest instincts. The Jewish comedians Ehrlich and Morgan. The comedian Geron. Jews consider portrayal of disreputable and repellent particularly fertile ground for comic effect. The Jew, Kurt Bois, enjoys a particularly perverted role. Jew is instinctively interested in everything abnormal and depraved. He seeks possibilities of disrupting a people's healthy judgment.